My name is Greg Fairchild, and I come from the University of Virginia, and I'm here with this wonderful group to talk about the work we all do. These folks are all leaders in these organizations that are a part of a larger story going on in our country. And if I look at the number of people in the room, I think all of you recognize the importance, the critical importance at this time in our nation and in our, and actually across nations for the types of work, the types of challenges, the type of questions these folks are wrestling with. So, how we'll spend our time. We're gonna talk as a group for about 40 minutes. We should anticipate many of you have some things you've been wanting to ask. We've got three great organizations and three great leaders. And so, we're gonna open the floor for Q&A, probably in our last 20 minutes, recognizing these folks are all gonna be here for the remainder of the conference. And so if you don't get your question in during our official time, you'll have a chance to talk to them as you go along. And from what I can tell, they're all friendly, they're all engaging, and I'm sure they'll be happy to talk with you. So just very briefly, you can all take a look at the bios. You can all take a look at the bios, and you can all have a chance to look at the backgrounds of the individuals that we have here. But just very quickly, Ann Williams-Isom.
Isom.
Very sorry. I've insulted Ann's husband. He doesn't know me. And I'm already on a bad foot. I can think I can handle David Banks. And then finally, Shawn, last name?
Dove.
Dove.
No. It's Dove.
Dove. You see? See how people treat me? Okay. So we're going to go ahead and get started, and I think you can see we're going to have fun, but we're also going to be serious. So again, take a look at their bios. Get yourself acquainted with who these folks are. What I'd like to do as a start is I'd like each of these folks to tell us a story about why they're here. Because there are other things they could be doing with their time, but there's some reason they've made affirmative choices about the work that they do. And there's some reason that there was a spark, a moment, when they decided to take the steps that they have that lead us to this room. And so I'm going to begin with Ann.
So, where's my microphone? Good afternoon, everybody. I feel bad. You know, I'm going to want to stand up because I can't see you, but I'm going to stay seated. I think why I'm here today is because, as we were just talking, I grew up in Queens. I'm the youngest of four. I was raised by a mom who came to this country as an immigrant from Trinidad and Tobago. She didn't have anything other than what she wanted from us, which was a dream to have something better in this country. She was a victim of domestic violence. She came here and she had, thankfully, a job as a registered nurse and put us through a good school and did the best that she could during all of her years in raising us to make sure that she gave us some resilience growing up in a house where there was so much trauma, so many things that could have kept my brothers and I from really accomplishing what we needed to accomplish. And so somehow, I think I figured out that what children need mostly is they need someone to believe in them, they need security. Even if they go through traumatic experiences and don't have the right pieces at the beginning, how can we get them connected to something that can heal them and that can put them on the path of success? I think I was really clear that she really focused on education and us having that. So the importance of education as the center stone of getting kids to and through in communities out of poverty. And so when I had the opportunity to, I'm a lawyer by training. I don't call myself an educator. I'm a child advocate. And so when I had the opportunity to follow the great Jeff Canada and do this work in the Harlem Children's Zone, which is my community, where I'm raising my own three children, it was a dream come true. So that's why I'm here today.
You know, Ann, if you could talk a little bit just about what the notion behind Harlem Children's Zone is in terms of your model of change. Because I'm sure many people in the room, if they've seen movies like Waiting for Superman.
If they saw that movie, then they have the wrong notion.
Okay,
so
good.
So I'm going to tell them what
it's
about.
I'm glad you're going to fix that.
And it's not a notion. It's a bold idea. It is, what would we do if we could do everything that we would do for our own children? And this idea of, can we end intergenerational poverty? Not can we educate one child, not can we get one child through college. It's about an entire community. So what we do is we start literally from baby college and work with families from the time they think about becoming a parent and know that babies and kids don't come with a handbook. And we work with the community. We have early childhood programs. We have after school programs. We have 1,028 young people who are in college right now. And so when I say that to people, they say, oh, that's a charter school model. Only 128 of those children came from our charter school. So the majority of children that we serve in those 97 blocks, it's a little over 10,000 children, I consider myself a mini mayor of Harlem, go to traditional public schools. So the strategies, the innovations, the family services that we have available really is to the majority of children that live there. It's a place-based strategy because I really want to prove that no matter who those kids bump into, those kids are going to be doing positive things. They're going to be going to school. And college is the North Star that we hold up so that they know that we believe that they can do that. There are some, and we'll talk about that later, they may not decide that they want to go to college right away. And so how do we help them make those intelligent decisions for themselves? And so we're thinking about health, we're thinking about crime, and we're thinking about Harlem being the community that we know that it can be and has been, which is the center and the mecca of African-American culture in this community, and really having it so that it can be a model for the rest of the country.
You know, David, I'd love it if you follow. What's your story? Why are you here? What's the model?
I am actually going to stand just because I did want to connect with some of the folk in the back. I know who's kind of struggling to see us up here. So good afternoon, everyone. Why am I here? I'm the oldest of three sons. My mom and dad, Philip and Janice Banks, had three boys right here in New York City. I liked school. I did well in school. My youngest brother, Terry, same kind of thing. Then there was the middle child, Philip, who was a whole different story. He was the one that if a teacher was calling the house, I knew they weren't calling for me. Right? And so Philip was the one who... First of all, let me ask you this. How many of you have sons? Or little nephews, brothers, husbands? How many of you know that boys are different from girls?
Amen, amen.
All right? So we kind of start from that place. So my mom and dad had three boys. And so my story is really my brother Philip, who was the one who the teachers said, we don't really expect that he's going to amount to very much. He was the one that was a real handful in school and had an energy that bounced off the walls that because the teachers were not fully prepared to how to deal with him, they diagnosed his boy behavior as something much more egregious than that. And so they recommended that he be put on medication. They recommended that he be placed in special education. And he was only supported by the fact that he had a great mom and dad who said, our child will not be a statistic. You're going to provide him the level of supports that he needs, and we will do the same thing at home. Philip actually went on to graduated from high school, followed my father after graduating from college on the New York City Police Department, where my dad was a lieutenant for 27 years. And Philip made his way up the ladder because he had my dad, who was a strong father, who was his mentor. And Philip became, and they have the same name. And so Philip went on to become a sergeant, one rank below my dad. And we were very proud. Then a few years later, guess what? He got promoted again, and he became a lieutenant. So it was a big story that was covered in the Daily News. Father and son, the same name, both on the NYPD. Philip's teachers in the first, second, third, fifth grade would have never imagined that Philip would have gone on to do that. But the story got better. 2 years later, Philip got promoted again to captain, one rank above my father, to which my father said, it is time to retire. That the day that you have to salute your own son, it's time to go. Philip went on to become a chief on the New York City Police Department, earning the rank of 1-star, then 2-star, then 3-star, then ultimately 4-star, which is the highest rank other than the police commissioner. I say that to say this. The level of expectation that happens so often for black boys in New York and around the country places them on a path where they're not able to be successful. And we decided here in New York to do more than have a conference about it, to do more than write a book about it, to do more than analyze data, which is actually to get out there and create schools specifically to try and address the issues of those boys. And so with that, we created what's called the Eagle Academy for Young Men. It's the first all-boys public schools in New York City in more than 30 years when we created it 10 years ago. And we went from having 100 boys in the ninth grade to a model now that starts at grade 6 takes the young men all the way through grade 12. We have almost 3,000 young men now. We're in every single borough in New York City, in addition to being in Newark, New Jersey, because we decided that I wanted to make sure that all of these young men got the same levels of support that we, my brothers and I, received from my mom and dad. After-school programs, extended day activities, Saturday work, mentors for boys who are growing up without fathers, who need men to stand in the gap and help them in that journey toward manhood. So it's all of those kinds of things that we are actually trying to work on, Dr. Fairchild, and building a system that will really help to engage black boys.
Great. Hello, everyone. I was a little worried with David going before me. I know we only had an hour. I had to give him a push, right? As you can tell, I know these two people very well, and they're phenomenal leaders. My name is Shawn Dove, and I'm the CEO of the Campaign for Black Male Achievement. I'm a native New Yorker. I've lived in every borough except for Staten Island. I'm a product of a single-parent household. My mother immigrated here from Jamaica when she was 18 years old. And as she was raising me, I never lived with my dad, right? Got to know my dad. But she was a single mom. She was determined. Education was really important. And we had lived in the South Bronx in my early years. But she was working, and what she decided to do was find somewhere during the week where I can live. And I lived in Harlem on 119th Street and Lenox Avenue, and then I would spend my weekends with my mother, and my mother would ship me away every summer for camp, and that was my experience. And then at fifth grade, we moved to the Upper West Side to live together. And I began to hang out and was not a hard kid, although I was faking it like I was. And so some of my friends were hanging out on the corner of 80th Street and Amsterdam Avenue on the Upper West Side. Didn't look anything like 80th Street and Amsterdam Avenue looks now. We're talking the 70s. And we were selling loose joints, right? I know no one in here knows anything about loose joints, right? Just look straight ahead if you do, or blink your eyes. And I was doing that not because I had to, but I was doing it just because all my friends were doing it. Came up with catchy slogans like, pass me by, you won't get high, and, you know, selling loose joints. And then my friends came over to me and they said, there's a youth program on 80th Street between Broadway and Amsterdam Avenue in the basement of All Angels Church. There's a basketball team, and they were giving away sneakers and uniforms. And I ran over there, and by the time I got there, they had given away the last pair of sneakers and the last uniform, and they said I couldn't be in the team. And I walked into this big room. I was really dejected. I walked into this room. It was about this size in the basement of All Angels Church, and there was a bunch of kids in that room, and there were adults in there, and they were all calling this one guy, John, John, I need help with my homework. John, I need help with this. Kids were playing backgammon. Kids were playing Connect Four. And so my mother had a lot of books, right? And I would go and look at the books and try to find, like, the dirty sections of the book as a teenager, right? But there was one book called Helter Skelter. And when I saw this guy, John, he looked like a really tall Charles Manson. And I said, what is this, some kind of cult? But it wasn't a cult. It was a youth program. Right? And I eventually got, it's called the Dome Project, I eventually got onto their basketball team, but I was dancing on both sides of the street. My corner on 80th Street and Amsterdam Avenue, when I was selling loose joints, pass me by, you won't get high, was two blocks away from my youth program, and I was dancing on both sides of the street. And then one day John came up to me, and he said to me, Shawn, you have potential. If you spend less time on the corner of 80th and Amsterdam, and more time at the Dome, you can do really great things. And here I was, two blocks away selling loose joints, thinking that John didn't know what I was doing. At the Dome, I got my first job, got engaged in youth organizing. There was a vacant lot on 84th Street between Amsterdam and Columbus Avenue. The basketball team transformed that empty lot into a beautiful community garden. For years after that, any first date that I went on, we were going to look at this garden, and I would say, you see this garden? Me and my friends, we created it, right? They gave me an opportunity to create, an opportunity to give back. But let me tell you the powerful thing about the Dome and that experience, because we all, you know, and I spent time in the mentoring field, need adults, caring adults, to believe in us sometimes when we don't believe in ourselves. And John and all the other adults did that for me. 12 years later, after walking into the dorm to get on their basketball team, I became their executive director and came back to lead that organization. And that was the power of youth development. That's the power of the dome. And I started my career after college selling textiles in the garment district, and I was on the dome's board, and I realized through my mentoring experiences, there was a seed, there was a social justice community organizing seed that was sown in me, and I knew that selling textiles was not my calling. Fast forward, you know, I spent some time at the Harlem Children's Zone and under the leadership of Jeff Canada. But in 2008, I had the opportunity to join the Open Society Foundation. They were launching something called the Campaign for Black Male Achievement, where they were going to invest a 3-year campaign to improve the life outcomes of black men and boys in the United States. Now, I'll tell you the curious genesis story about the Campaign for Black Male Achievement. There was a 2006 article, cover of the New York Times, front page, left corner, upper fold. You don't get any better real estate than that. And it said, the plight of black men deepens in the United States. And for many of us, it wasn't front news story, right? We knew this. And there was a curious debate at the foundation. They said, we need to get involved and do something about this. But there were folks on the board that said, and on staff, well, we're already invested in black male achievement. Look at our criminal justice fund. We're investing $20 million a year in criminal justice reform. Very important work, yes, but here was an opportunity for us to invest in the front end of the prison pipeline. And so it was a 3-year campaign. The blessing and burden of having a living donor in George Soros is that your portfolio can blow up in a board meeting, or you can be looking for a job after a board meeting. But there was a board meeting when we made our presentation, and he said, I like what I see. I'm taking off your term limits. I'm tripling your budget. And what he did, in fact, was make a big, bold bet in the growing field of black male achievement. And what I decided at that time was America doesn't need a campaign for black male achievement. We can't address this issue in a grant-making, 3-year, 5-year cycle. What we needed was an endowed philanthropic enterprise to lean into this issue for the long haul. And I was able to convince the campaign to the foundation to invest in spinning off the campaign for black male achievement, and we focus on the infrastructure and the movement building of this work that you're here to hear about today.
So if you aren't already excited about what we're about to hear, let me say a little bit about my own personal story and why I'm here. You know, I'm moved by the degree to which these individuals have all shared that our story, our American story, our black American story, comes with it challenges, comes with it investments, comes with the support of our families. And mine is no different. You know, my parents, my grandparents made the investments many parents make in preparing me for the life I would have. But I'm very aware as well that sometimes it's the movement of individuals and organizations that make substantial differences. You see, I'm the child of a military officer. And for what that might mean to some of you is that even though I was born in 1963, and even though I began elementary school in 1968 in Alabama, what that might mean for some of you that would know is that I've always attended integrated schools, because the military always had integrated schools. When Annie talks about poverty, my grandparents also served, both my grandfather and grandmother. They were some of the few black beneficiaries of a wonderful thing called the Servicemen's Readjustment Act, what many of you will know as the GI Bill. Many blacks who served did not receive the loans that actually grew mortgage housing in the United States. And what we know is the 20-year self-amortizing mortgage was created by our federal government to support military veterans. Because of that, my father grew up in a middle-class home, a home that my grandparents owned. He was able to go to a private college. And of course, as I've said, he had the serendipity of entering the military in 1956. In 1954, Eisenhower had made by executive order all military units immediately forthwith integrated. And so my life was very different than my father's life and very different than my grandfather's life, even as though they were both all college-educated individuals. What I have benefited from, and I'm very aware of, is that I wasn't in an urban setting, but I was in settings where there had been given me and afforded me the opportunity of an equal education, the promise that had been made at Brown, still yet to be delivered. We'll talk a little bit as we go along about the personal. I hope I'll also have time to tell you about our work in prisons that we do at the University of Virginia, because it's something I feel pretty excited about. But I'm going to shift, and we're going to talk a little bit about this notion of movement, because the title of this session is about movement. And I'd love it if our panelists could talk a little bit about what movement are we talking about? What is that movement responding to? What's the problem that we're facing, and why have they constructed their organizations to handle the problem the way they have? And so that you don't have to go behind David, Shawn, I'll start with you.
Sure. There is a unprecedented movement around black male achievement and improving the life outcomes of black boys and men of color in this country now. And this is work that has been happening for decades and generations. But most recently, as many of you may know, the president made a declaration that this is a national priority, and he created something called My Brother's Keeper Initiative. And most recently, My Brother's Keeper Alliance. And what that really did was elevate the conversation. And you ask why? Why focus on black boys? Why focus on Latino boys? And I would first just direct everyone to the data. When we look at the data, the life outcomes of black and Latino boys across the board, they're at the bottom of the positive life outcome indicators and at the top. And as we have heard, that this is not just a black community issue or problem. This is America's challenge. This is America's problem and opportunity to deal with. But the whole notion, Greg, when you talk about movement, right, and movements are led by individuals, it's led by institutions. One of the things that is really critical for us to take a look at are the institutions and the ability to strengthen the infrastructure and the capacity of organizations that are doing this. Because there's a cry across the country, well, we want better outcomes, but the organizations, the systems, are so fragile that they don't have the support to do that. I think the first thing that we need to do, and why we are having this type of conversation at Concordia, probably the first ever of its like, we need to make a declaration in this nation that black men and boys are not the problem. The problem is the system and the structures in which they are growing up in, right? And I think that's the first thing, that we have to say that, you know what, black men and boys are assets, and there are assets that we are wasting, human capital that we are wasting. That's one. The other thing, when we talk about movement building, this is a cross-sector a strategy. People come to me and they say the campaign for black male achievement, is this only for black men? No, this is a all races, all gender. The president of the Chicago Community Foundation, Terry Manzani, who has spoken out on this and is investing in Chicago. I said, we need more people like you to show that white men can jump for black male achievement. And so I am here to also say that while black men and boys is the point of departure, this is a community building strategy. You heard about my single mom and the impact that she has. So making a declaration, building the brand of this work is one. Cross-sector leadership, strategic partnerships is another. The third thing, and I said this before, you have to invest in leadership development and organizational sustainability, that this is the long haul. Some folks are in this for a reason, or a season, but we're in this for the reason. The fourth thing I will say is having, when we look at the movement, taking a look at the data, measuring and promoting what works. And I'm going to turn the mic over to David, who is running a national recognized strategy and education on what works, but measuring and promoting what works. And the last thing is sustainability and looking at this for the long haul. Every day when I wake up, it's sustain the campaign. sustain the campaign. And so what was a three-year campaign launched in 2008 with grit, with desire, with influence, having the right board members who believed in this work, we were able to spin the campaign off for an independent standing organization for the long haul to catalyze this movement.
Can I go out of order? Because you were, Shawn, you were making me think a lot of things. I actually have three children. I have two girls and I have a boy. And I hadn't thought about this in a while, but when I found out, I have a Philip. He's a Philip. When I found out that Philip was a boy and I was lying on the table and they did the sonogram, I started to cry. I was like, what is it going to be like to raise a boy in America? And it was weird. And my husband was like, oh, you're happy? And I was like, no, I'm not happy. I just gave birth, you know, I'm going to give birth to public enemy number one. And while I should have been happy, my firstborn was a little girl. She was 2.5 years old. I remember feeling about that responsibility of bringing a black boy into this world. The strategy that we do, and the reason why I'm so committed to it, is because I think I'm obsessed with this concept of concentrated poverty and why that's okay. And why, if I go 35 blocks from where I live, their kids and they're in school and they're happy and they're playing and their moms have good health care and everybody seems to be, they're struggling. There's still kids that have special needs. There's still kids that have all kinds of stuff, but everybody seems to be managing in a way that seems okay. I think I'm obsessed with the fact that in my community, I said we served a little over 12,000 kids last year. And in New York City right now, we have 12,000 inmates in Rikers Island. And so there's a map that we have, and Shawn, you've seen this, in the Harlem Children's Zone, where it shows our zone. And the redder the area, the higher the rates of incarceration. And the zone is just bright red with the amount of kids in that community that are incarcerated. And so I think about my boy, I think about my Philip, and then I think about all the boys in the Harlem Children's Zone, and having to navigate that every day. Every time I bring funders into that room, they're like, well, where's that black area down here? I don't want to live in that red area. And what that must be like to raise kids in a period, in a place of concentrated poverty, where they don't have access to the things that they need, where they have poor education, and where they're trying to figure out how to become men and not having the examples that they need. And so for me, we've decided that we're going to focus on all of the children. I also have in my mind this little one. He was 4 years old, and we have a GEMS program for 240 of our 3 and 4 year olds. And so we have a cozy corner in the classrooms because we want young people, especially boys, to be able to express themselves in terms of their anger or their happiness, to be able to use their words for their emotions, right? That goes back to the trauma I talked about and the toxic stress and how that is really prevalent when you live in concentrated poverty. And so as he was sitting in there having a moment, not quite a timeout, but the kids get to place themselves in there. I think a couple of adults need a cozy corner during the day, right? And so as he was there, I went and I sat with him for a little bit. And I said, oh, do you know, you want me to read you a book? Would you like to, you know, read this book? I could read this book with you. And he looked at me, he said, Miss, I can't read. And I was like, what you mean you can't read? And so I took the book with him, and we started going through the pictures. And I was like, what is that? And he was like, that's a zebra. And what's this? It's a flower. And we named it all. I said, well, you can read. He's like, that's not reading. I said, that is reading. You are a pre-reader. And started to talk to him about these expectations. And so I think about in my community, every time somebody sees a little boy, even me, when I was giving birth to my own child, my first thought was about the negative. It wasn't about, oh, I'm giving birth to a king or a prince. It was, Lord, have mercy. How am I going to negotiate this world with this boy? And so that's why we do the world. That's what a movement is about. It's about taking that pathology that has been fed to us and changing it and making a counter narrative about what needs to happen for them, for that four-year-old, so that he can have the words to express and heal and feel resilient, so that when he's in college, as so many of them come to me and say, Miss Ann, I don't belong here. I don't belong in college. I don't belong doing this work. Who told them that? And how do they believe that? How do we change that? And to me, that is the real work, and that's why we're doing the work that we're doing in the way that we're doing it, and that's what the movement is about.
I think it was great you went ahead of David. David?
I don't know what all this, but David came from. Yeah. We didn't start out trying to start a movement or be part of a movement. We were just trying to do something, because I think there were a group of us who were part of this from the organization 100 Black Men who are looking at the negative data, like so many others have looked at. We saw back when we started in 2004 that the graduation rate for African-American males in New York City was 32%. I mean, you stop and you think about that for a second. That means you could line up 10 young men across the front of this room, and you could tell seven of them they're going to have a seat. You're not even going to graduate from high school. That was one. The other one was that Columbia University had put out a report that said that, to Ann's point, 75% of the inmates for the entire state of New York came from seven neighborhoods in New York City. I mean, if you just wrap your mind around that for a minute, right? That hot spotting. 75% of this entire state's prison population, you're talking about Syracuse, Albany, Buffalo, Rochester, come from not just New York City. They're not coming from Bayside, Queens. Very specific zip codes. And that's the work that the Harlem Children's Zone has been dealing with in the Harlem community. But there are other neighborhoods as well with this deep concentration of poverty, low expectations, poor performing schools. It is the proverbial prison pipeline. The problem that we saw was that we've done really well in having evaluations done, research projects that have been done. People are writing the books, talking about the issues. And Lord knows, we brought panel discussions and conferences to an art form. I mean, we know how to do those. We know how to do that very, very well. But when you looked on the ground and said, okay, where are the real solutions? Who's actually on the ground trying to do something to address this issue? That was few and far between. And you know, you'd see some who had a nice after-school program for 25 kids and patting themselves on the back. And we said, but as my friend Jeff Canada would say, you know, we're saving these kids by the hundreds and losing them by the thousands. So unless you're bold and audacious in trying to do something bigger and bolder, you're never going to catch up that way. And so, you know, but we just put one foot in front of the other, created this school in the Bronx. I had been a school teacher, an assistant principal, a principal for 13 years in New York. And so I was steeped in this work and working with young people in the schools, and a father of four children, including three sons. So I knew what this was about. And it, as we engaged in it, I realized it was the hardest work that I was ever a part of. The co-ed school that I was a principal of before Eagle Academy, we did extremely well because the girls ruled. I mean, the girls carried the school. They run for all the leadership positions. They are in every club and activity that you can name. And the boys just want to be cool and sit in the back of the room. And so this notion of, you know, what happens with the boys, and people would say, well, why do you need a whole initiative focused on boys? I mean, why don't we just have good educational policy that, you know, a rising tide will lift all boats? And I would say that the rising tide doesn't lift your boat if your boat has cement in it, right? And so you've got to put practices in place that will remove the cement from the boat. And that's what we have tried to put in place in the work that we're doing at the Eagle Academy by having boys engage after school. Not just so that they're engaged in these activities to just be running around, but first of all, the data shows all of the problems for boys after school, the fights, the gunplay, they all happen within that 3 to 6 p.m. time frame. So if you've got them engaged during that time frame, it makes all the difference in the world. We bring the boys to school on Saturdays. We figured out ways to engage parents in a way that very few schools have done. I'll give you one example. We bring all of our parents together to discuss everything that's happening at the school on Saturday mornings. Why? Because the traditional public schools bring parents to school on a Tuesday and Wednesday night at 6 and 7 o'clock, and you get the same 25 parents that come out. Because that is a time frame that works well for school personnel. If you want to meet them halfway and do something that works well for the parents, do it on a Saturday morning and feed them. Because it's cultural as well. So it's all of these, it's kinds of things. How you train and have strategies for teachers to engage boys properly. Most teachers really mean well. They just have never been trained or gotten any level of real professional development around what it means to work with a Philip in the class. When he's in the room, most teachers in America are white and female. Right? And so they kind of naturally gravitate to the girls. The girls, they look and they see the girls in the room. The girls remind them of themselves. Right? They want to be like the teacher. They sit, they behave. And then you've got this group of boys that are coming out of a whole nother bag. And there's nothing wrong with the boys. It's just a little different. It's a different energy. But if that teacher has not been properly developed in how to see that and not see it as a deficit or anything negative, then it's hard to even blame the teacher when they get it wrong, because nobody has shown them the proper way on how to engage them. And that's what we do.
You know, let me at this point tell you about the back end of what you all are experiencing. And let me tell the rest of the room about the work we've been doing. So on Tuesday afternoon, I taught an entrepreneurship class to 47 MBA students at our business school. We talked about ways that you do private equity financing and recapitalization transactions, which some people in the room would probably love to talk about. At 5:30 in the afternoon, I was at the Dilwyn Correctional Facility. The Dilwyn Correctional Facility is a male correctional facility an hour south of our school. How did I get there? 4 years ago, our dean received a letter that was typewritten. I'd not seen a typewritten letter since I was a little kid. And the typewritten letter had a gentleman's name in the right-hand corner and had a number. And the letter said, "Hi, I'm preparing to make a transition from prison. I'm interested in, I've been out before. I've had real problems in the job market. And my hope, my desire is that I can make this transition in a way that I can build on the vocational education I have." He had already been an auto shop. And he knew that eventually one who works in a shop might want to run one. Well, I happen to teach entrepreneurship, and I happen to teach business strategy. And just to fast forward, that was 4 years ago. We have since graduated 127 ex-offenders, and I use that language particularly, from an education program, not only in that male facility, but in a female facility, and not only in a female facility, but in a juvenile justice facility. And this education is 300 hours a year. All happens behind bars. And we do what people do in business schools. We do case method instruction. We do instruction where if someone's been in a classroom where they could sit in the back and no one saw them, or they avoided them, or they ignored them, we have a class where everyone's expected to speak. And what we hear from the men is that this is one of the first times in their educational experience someone looked at them and said, "What do you think we should do? What type of advice would you give? What is the analysis that you have? And can you tell everyone in the room about it?" And our program, again, now in its fourth year, has had a magnificent response from the folks in our correction system. I think sometimes we have an impression of corrections systems and even police officers that there's no desire to help, but oftentimes there is. But I think the biggest thing that I found striking about our work is that we've received a good bit of press, and I think we've received press because not only of this bigger movement and this bigger question, but because on some level we are a man bites dog story. People in affluent, high-end business schools don't go behind bars. And so when reporters talk to me, they often want to know, "Well, why are you doing this? What are you guys getting paid? Where's the study that you're doing? Is this a lab experiment?" There's such a tradition of those of us who have been prepared, who have resources, who have engagement, and who have had lives where we're very sure that we're successful because of all the wonderful skills we have. We unfortunately have a tradition where those of us at the top often aren't perceived as being willing to go behind bars. We're okay with giving money, but we're not always okay with going there. 75 of our MBA students over the last 4 years have taught, and they are teaching tonight as we speak. So this is the type of work we hope will grow, because our sense is there's a business school and a university next to every prison in the United States. Our sense is there, if 75 MBA students in Little Charlottesville, Virginia would be interested in doing this, hundreds would do it in New York City. And so our notion is that part of the change connects people in our universities, faculty, students, and yes, even alumni, to people that are in these communities. Because I know so much of what we're talking about today is about youth, and we certainly work with youth, but just as there is a school-to-prison pipeline, let us not forget that there are 5 million ex-offenders in the United States, and that this number of people
if we fail to address it, if all of our work is on the front end, none of our work is on the back end, we, in the end, will not achieve what I think we all believe. I'm going to shift gears, and I'm going to pull on something that Anne, you began to talk about. And it's explaining to others our children, others our elected officials, other our businesses, other nonprofits in our area that have different missions. So much of the objectives of the summit is finding ways to bring people together under tents committed to how we solve problems, because we can't do it alone, right? So I'm hoping each of you might now talk about some partnership, some way that the notion behind what you were doing at the Eagle Academy, sure, the notion behind My Brother's Keepers, when you talk about an alliance, what does an alliance mean, and how can people partner and assist in the work you do?
Can I go first this time?
Yes, you can.
All right. I would say this. I think the very context that you just laid out is maybe the most important thing. This work cannot be done in silos. For all the work that Ann is doing at the Home Children's Zone and Shawn is doing and I'm doing, it works because of the connection to people, you know, kind of that coalition of the willing, if you will. You know, people who believe and who want to help. And quite frankly, that's you, right, in the room. Figuring out where do you get in. You know, we started a couple years ago our school in Harlem. We have a school in every borough in New York City. And we had a group who came to us to say they were getting ready to build a golf simulator facility. How many of you play golf? Just by a quick show of hands. Well, you ever go into a golf simulator facility, right? And so you get to kind of play the PGA Tour and whatnot, just kind of do a simulated activity. But they're building a simulator in Harlem and wanted to engage in a program with the Eagle Academy to teach our boys as early as the sixth grade over a seven-year period how to play golf, where they're going to be taking them out to Bridge Hampton to play the golf course out there over a period of time. Just one example. Kids who would have never kind of had that level of exposure. News Corporation, J.P. Morgan Chase, all of these corporations that have the resources, have the means, and connecting and doing special programs with those schools and with those organizations for the kids in the schools, providing internship opportunities, anything that will help the light to go on. It's hard to dream of being an investment banker if you've never seen or met an investment banker, right? And so kids have got to be exposed, and so the business community, I think, should take great interest in this issue, and because you have the opportunity to play a very significant role in helping young people to see the possibilities for themselves, right? And so, and the final thing I would just say in regard to that is, this is not just a good moral story, you know. Let's see what we can do to kind of help some of those kids over there that are really struggling up in Harlem, over in Ocean Hill, Brownsville. You know, what I'm saying is that this is an economic imperative for this nation. That in an increasingly diverse country, we cannot afford as a nation to have this much wasted human capital sitting on the sidelines. These are the people that have to contribute to our 401ks and Social Security and everything else. So it's not just some little small marginal group that, you know, we decide, hey, let's see what we can do, a good thing and feel good about ourselves. If we don't support and invest properly, I think we do that to our own detriment.
Yeah. Partnerships?
Yes, partnerships. So I love the last one that you said, internships. My Philip now is 20 years old, and he just started his sophomore year at Wharton at UPenn. And when he finished his first year, and his dad and I were saying to him, so what are you going to do over the summer? He said to us, oh, I thought I would learn how to skateboard and read some and catch up on movies. We were like, no. No, you're not going to do that. And we, you know, like, so having boys that you can talk to and that you can say, okay, let's help you write your resume, and you're going to do, you're going to have some fun, but you're going to get an internship somewhere, and you're going to do that. So I really feel like the young people in our organization that are college age and that are now putting their toe into the water, many of them don't have dads that are going to be like, let me help you with your resume and let me give you an internship. And really, they need to, I hate to say it, we need to hold their hand through the process because they've never been in companies and things like that before. So anyone who wants to give any of my young people internships, I am open to that. We have a big Healthy Harlem project. You know, we're looking at asthma, we're looking at obesity in my community. Health, I'm always looking for people for my advisory board, pediatricians, other people who can give us some ideas about how do we keep these young people in this community healthier. And the last thing I have been talking about is mental health services. I need people who are good, not just who are counselors, but are really good, high quality, preferably people of color, preferably men that I can send my young boys to who need help and who can have conversations with them. So those are just some of the things that are on my mind.
So what's always on my mind is the declaration that you know, the cavalry is not coming to save the day in our communities across the country, right? That we are the iconic leaders that we're waiting for, the curators of the change that we're hoping to see. And you may be sitting here like, well, God, what does this movement of black male achievement have to do with me, right? We are all connected, whether you believe it or not. We will not live up to the values and the ideals of this great nation if we have an entire population of people that just have this barrier and threshold. So when we talk about this movement, it's about finding a way to connect everyone to contribute, to get in where you can fit in. So whether it's your time, your talent, or your treasure, some of you can just write a check, right? You don't have to write it to the Harlem Children's Own. They got a lot of money. Don't write it to David Banks. He just got a big check. You can write to the campaign. No. So there's something that you can do. But when you think about partnerships, and one of the things I really I'm grateful about the president launching My Brother's Keeper Alliance, because it really widened the tent for the private sector to get engaged in this movement. And one such partnership that the Campaign for Black Male Achievement is engaged in, because our mission is about building the capacity of the organizations and the leaders that are doing the work, investing in the, what I like to say, the hometown heroes and local leaders. And we just formed a three-way partnership between JPMorgan Chase and an organization called Catch a Fire, which does skill-based volunteerism. In fact, their CEO is doing a presentation right now in another room. And so what we're doing, we are matching in three markets, New York, Chicago, and Los Angeles, JPMorgan Chase volunteers to the Campaign for Black Male Achievement member organizations for short-term skill-based projects. Some of these projects are around developing marketing plans. Some of these projects are around developing board a development strategy, and it's not a long-term commitment. Some of them are as short as a four-week engagement. Some of them as long as 8 weeks. Get in and get out. And what it is doing is introducing JPMorgan Chase employees in their own cities, in communities that may have on their way to work passed by, and making those kind of connections. And so there are bunch of opportunities like that. And so that's just one example of a partnership with a private sector. We do need more faith-based partnerships, a not-for-profit like the campaign, and a social enterprise like Catch a Fire.
You know, I'm so glad you reminded me. You know, a big part of our motivation for our work is that it's important that our MBAs go behind bars. It's important that they do the teaching. I do the teaching, but it's important that people who will be in hiring decisions, who will go to JPMorgan Chase, McKinsey, so on and so forth, will have a sense that what they've heard or seen on television isn't true. They'll know individuals, and they'll know individual stories. Okay, I think it's about that time that we turn this over.
Every time we
I get choked up when I go.
It's fantastic.
Thank you. I think what you do is too. We're going to go.
Greg, I just want to make one point before we open up.
Okay.
And this is about real-time connections. I know for a fact in this room there is someone that is formerly incarcerated and has been devoting his career since his incarceration to building community and is looking to do exactly what you're talking about. So before you leave here, I'm going to make sure that you two are connected.
So you should tell this person that tomorrow I will be in the afternoon at Columbia University. We'll be talking about bringing a similar program to New York City.
See how the spirit's working up in here?
Spirit is moving.
I'm just saying.
Okay, we're gonna go to the Q&A.
All right.
Now, here's the thing. As we go to the questions, I'm going to take my prerogative to tell you, I've been in these rooms before. I do not want to hear it is so great, you inspire me, I'm so glad you're here.
Hey, hey.
I mean, we know that.
We know
these folks are inspiring. What we want is we want questions that are challenging. So if you don't even agree, you question the motivation altogether, that we want to hear from you. So we'd like you to speak into a microphone. And so Carol Merrill, The Price is Right, is going to help us out by bringing the microphones around.
Okay, I'm going to try to challenge you. Do you realize that 39% of households in New York City...
I'm being told you should stand up so we can all see.
Oh, I'm sorry. My name's Steve Marks. I'm with a group called 545 Holding Partners. And my question is, do you realize that 39% of households in New York City, where we're attending the Concordia Summit today, cannot pay their bills? And this all relates to something called the Living Wage Index. That's the entire city. It's not just your communities, but obviously your communities are impacted, those of you from New York City. What are you going to do to address that? Thank you.
So it's interesting that you even said that statistic, because we are now, our new building that we just built in the middle of the St. Nicholas houses, we were looking at the average income of a family of four, and it's $21,000 a year. And we also found out 67% of the families there are being raised by a single mom. So when you talk about living wage, I think about that. And also that over 50% of the households, there's no one working. So when I think about the culture, and sort of when we talk about, how are we kids going to think I'm going to go to college and I'm going to get a job and there's not anybody that I even see doing that, I think for me, this idea about giving kids the ability to say, we're going to do something, you're going to do something different, you're going to get a college degree, I think that's why we sort of, if you know the history of the Harlem Children's Zone, it was about going to high school. Then it was about graduating from high school. And we're like, if we want kids to be competitive, they're going to have something a little bit more. I'm not going to work to change the economy in terms of starting jobs or doing labor or employment. We used to do that in the past. Actually, Shawn, you were there when we were doing that. And Jeff was like, that's not our sweet spot. That's not what we're good at. But what we want to do is we want to have a workforce that someone will want to hire and that they will have some skills and have been working with some organizations to get the kids connected to that. So I think for us, that is our strategy to poverty. But it's something that's really serious. And I appreciate you saying that, because I feel like I live in the middle of that and trying to figure out how do we dig ourselves out of that.
And I just want to say I totally agree with Ann's analysis of that. It's not just what are we going to do, right? There are lots of organizations out here. These are deep, profound, complex problems. The issue of poverty, you're not going to find a solution in a bottle, right? So there are lots of organizations that are out here working. We need to figure out some ways to connect those organizations in that work as well. Part of our response to it is in helping to try to educate the children, right? Because the notion that while you're in poverty, that's somehow almost suggests that kids can't learn or kids can't achieve because their parents, have all these other challenges is something that I absolutely do not accept. So I'm saying that in spite of those things, we've got work to do. And then there are other organizations that are helping to fight this battle. This is a huge battle. It's a huge battlefront. And you don't want to look at it as this huge elephant, because sometimes people get neutralized. They look at the problem and say, this is so big that, you know what, I'm not going to bother to do anything. Everybody's got to do their bit that they can do, and you kind of break it down that way.
You know, Steve, we want to thank you for taking us to task. Let's see if we can get another one of those.
Hi, everyone. My name is Miguel Sanchez. I work in the Bronx, and I have a company called Mass Ideation. We create emerging technology, and I've actually done courses at Harlem Children's Zone teaching a lot of the young people these emerging technologies. The struggles I have as a small business owner in the Bronx is it's hard for me to hire or even give these people paid internships because I struggle day to day to just keep my lights on. Imagine trying to bring in 20 kids that are trying to learn and not be able to pay them. And what I struggle with, and I have to teach them, and it's bad to have to do, but I have to tell them, you have to kind of rely on working for free to learn this stuff, because there's not going to be a lot of people like me to give you opportunities, and the ones that do can't afford to. So it's a struggle for people like me in minority situations with businesses that are trying to scale our businesses, but also teach and grow the community, and that's where I feel like organizations like this could help companies like us.
Well, I think that speaks to the partnership. I would venture to say, Miguel, that's your name, that I would venture to say that there are organizations, community-based organizations in the South Bronx, and actually someone I went to Wesleyan with, Plinio Ayala, runs an organization called Per Scholar that teaches technology skills where you can partner with him, write a grant. Lots of STEM funding out there that his organization could get the grant to provide the stipends for young people in the South Bronx to come to your organization. And I know that you are in the business for for profit, and you know you work that out with the 501c3 and however. But there is, where there's a will, there are multiple ways. And I think it was David that said we have to be bold and innovative in our thinking. I know right where you are that there are some CBOs, community-based organizations, that will partner with you to leverage dollars from the philanthropic community to do what you want to do.
I would say this,
you get that. Oh, actually, this notion of partnerships. Yeah. I think that, again, this notion of trisectors, those of us in the nonprofit sector and those of us in the government sector are pretty good at ferreting out opportunities and programs that can be helpful for those of you in the public sector, be they a small business like you, Miguel, or a large. I'd love to go to one more question because we're about to run out of time. We can take one final question.
Thanks for your presentation. It was very inspiring. My name is Rania. I'm currently finishing up my MPA at New York University. And so we mentioned the replication of these programs in Los Angeles and Chicago. And my question is, what's the implications for doing this type of work in Mississippi or in suburban areas in Ohio where the inequality that exists is still great, but you don't have those urban structures to be working in? And just in light of that question, too, do you imagine that this is something that is more relevant to the U.S., or if I wanted to take that marginalized youth empowerment model, would I be able to apply that to Jakarta, to Aleppo, or is this something that's very centrally based in the history and dynamics of the U.S.?
You know, those are great, great questions. I would say this, you know, Sean just said, right, where there's a will, there's a way. Right? We started the school, this Eagle Academy, as a very just specific, focused response in the Bronx, and has grown from having 100 boys in the ninth grade to almost 3,000, and over the next several years, it'll grow to over 4,000 that we're working with. But again, my good friend Jeff Canada said to me, he said, you know, you actually can't brick and mortar your way out of this problem. So you got to think even more strategically around how you do it. And so, you know, we're actually getting ready within this year to launch what we call the Eagle Institute, where we're going to be helping to train schools and school systems in how to better engage and work with boys. This issue of what's happening with boys is not just a national crisis, it's an international crisis. I sit on the board of directors of the International Boys Schools Coalition, and this is a coalition of boys schools from Australia to London and to Africa. I mean, we just had our conference in South Africa a couple of months ago, and that work internationally, what's happening with boys of color, They're struggling all over the planet. But we think some of the work that we're doing is absolutely replicable. We're looking to do that. Well, but it means having strategic partnerships, right? So when you think about the question that you just raised around the challenges that you have, I see in the room we've got Assemblyman Michael. Could you just kind of raise your hand, right? So we've got
from the Bronx,
right? From the Bronx. That's part of the reason I wanted to kind of make that connection, right? Worked in the White House, back here providing leadership in the community. And he's got those kinds of connections as well.
I just wanted to say on Monday, I had the president of the Republic of Malta come to visit the Harlem Children's Zone. Everybody has a population that they're struggling with. I don't know, it's about a particular program. It's about the principles and what you could take. You don't have to take the whole model. You could take parts of it. So I think there's a lot to be learned from what we're doing.
You know, I'm going to back you up on another part of what you said. You know, the face of black poverty, the face of black challenge, the face issues in the United States, when we say that, we generally think of the Northeast, LA, Chicago. Those of you who are in the know that the majority of the black population still lives in the American South. Those of you who are in the know that the very problems that exist here in New York exist in Charlottesville, Virginia, a wonderful, beautiful college town. And so those of you in the know that too often, I think, the models that are done in urban settings don't filter down to the rural areas. And so what we hope we're doing in Charlottesville is we're migrating some to the big cities. I think the panel, can we all give them a hand? I want to thank you for all being here. As I said, these folks are committed to give of their time. They give it every day, but they're here to give their time to you. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Greg. Good
job.
Thank you.